This video is to allow you to correct your homework for section 4.1.3. First of all, I want to remind you in the methods and meanings that they talk about adding and subtracting mixed numbers, and that there's a couple of ways that it's commonly done. We know that we need common denominators when it comes to adding and subtracting fractions or mixed numbers. So one way to do it is to separate the 3 and 4 fifths. Think of it as the whole number 3 plus 4 fifths. The 1 and 2 thirds, think of it as 1 plus 2 thirds. And then get the common denominator between the fractional parts. So the least common denominator would be 15, which means we're multiplying 4 fifths by a giant 1 of 3 over 3. And then we're multiplying 2 thirds by a giant 1 of 5 over 5. For the fraction, then we get 12 fifteenths and 10 fifteenths. And then we can't forget about our whole number component, 3 and 1. We then add the fractional part, we add the whole number part, we get 4 and 22 fifteenths, but 22 fifteenths is a fraction greater than 1, so we would change that to a mixed number. So 22 fifteenths, we would take 22, sorry it's a little messy, divide by 15, and we're going to, you know, realize that 15 will go into 22 one whole time. 1 times 15 is 15. Subtract, we get 7. And so we have the mixed number 1 and 7 fifteenths. We're going to add that 1 and 7 fifteenths to the 4 that is here. And that gives us a total of 5 and 7 fifteenths. So that's one way to do it. Another way you can do it is to change the original mixed numbers into fractions greater than 1. So 6 times 2 plus 1 would give us 13 sixths. 5 times 1 plus 4 would give us 9 fifths. So because we have fractions greater than 1, we're going to get, again, a common denominator. And then we'll be working with larger fractions, but the process of getting the common denominator, the adding the numerators, doesn't change. And then we'll just take that final answer and change it into a mixed number. So either method will work just fine. It's really a matter of personal preference. Here, Julian was studying a pattern made with toothpicks, and he started this table. So figure 1 has 7 toothpicks, figure 2 has 10, figure 3 has 13. We can see that the number of toothpicks is going up by 3. So figure 4 would have 16 toothpicks, figure 5 would have 19. Then they want us to draw axes and plot the points. So again, it would be good if CPM put a title on this, maybe like Julian's pattern made with toothpicks or something. But everything else is correct. They went by ones horizontally for the figure number, and they went vertically by fives for the number of toothpicks, and then they plotted those points. They also have labels on the bottom and on the side, which was good. And so basically they're just showing this as a graph, which would be in quadrant 1, just positive x, positive y. Once we've done that, we can answer C. How can we describe what the points have in common? Well, we can see that if we connected these, they would make a straight line. And in math, we call that linear. For 4.35, you first are going to estimate the summer difference, and then go ahead and calculate the summer difference. So for A, we have about 5, and we're subtracting about 2. So our answer would be between 3 and 4. And then you need to show the work for the actual answer. So again, even though they use the word calculating, it means you're going to find the sum or difference. And so we need to show our work. So we're going to make this 5 and 20 hundredths minus 2 and 9 hundredths. Show your borrowing, your regrouping, and then get your answer. For B, we could say this is about 25, this is about 18, so our estimate would be between 7 and 8. And then we're going to need to subtract these, and when we subtract them, we can use either of the methods that I talked about in the math notes. You can go ahead and make the mixed numbers with common denominators and do the subtraction, or change them to fractions greater than 1 and do the subtraction. Now, I do want to mention about the mixed number technique. So you're going to go ahead and figure out what your common denominator will be, which of course is 6. We have been doing quite a bit with that, so hopefully we're pretty good at making that into 25 and 2/6 minus 17 and 5/6. But if you do this technique, you'll have to think about the fact that, again, you are now going to be trying to subtract 5/6 from 2/6. That would not become an issue if you went with the changing these to fractions greater than 1. But if we're going to do this method, which is absolutely fine, we'll have to say to ourselves 5/6 cannot be subtracted from 2/6, so we need to borrow from the 25, making it a 24. And we're going to be bringing over a whole 1, which is the same as 6/6. So if it had been eighths, you'd be bringing over 8/8. If it had been sevenths, you're bringing over 7/7. This is in 6, so we're bringing over 6/6. So then we're going to have 8/6 when we combine the 2/6 that were there with the 6/6 we brought over. When we subtract, then 8/6 minus 5/6 will be 3/6. And 24 minus 17 would be 7. We will have one last step, and that is to simplify our 3/6, divide top and bottom by 3, and we get an answer of 7.5. Again, if you prefer to do the changing them both to fractions greater than 1, that would be fine too, but make sure you're showing your work. Here we're going to get a common denominator of 28, and we're going to go ahead and add them. We're going to make sure that we're showing our work, but before we even do that, we should talk about our estimate. This is about 4. This is about 3. So our estimate would be between 6 and 7. And what you're going to find when you change these to common denominators of 28 is you're going to have 3 and multiply by 7 top and bottom here. You're going to get 21 28ths. And this one is going to be multiplying by 4 top and bottom, 2 and 20 28ths. And so when we add them, we end up getting 5 and 41 28ths. But 5 and 41 28ths, 41 28ths is a fraction greater than 1. So you'll have to change that 41 28ths into the whole number 1 with a remainder of 13 28ths. That's where your final answer is becoming 6 and 13 28ths. Here, in terms of an estimate again, you might say about 104 plus about 30. So the answer would probably be between 133 and 134. And then again, line up your decimal points, show your work, and you should get 133 and 17 hundredths. Here they want you to do the prime factorization. Now remember, there's a couple ways to do prime factorization. One is a factor tree. So you can say to yourself, all right, what two numbers will multiply to give me 36? I could go with 6 and 6, or I could have gone with 18 and 2. I could have gone with 4 and 9, lots of options. And then 6 would be 2 times 3. And this 6 would also break apart to be 2 times 3. And then we need to circle our answers once we get prime numbers. So what we have is 2 times 3 times 2 times 3, but with prime factorization, we need to have them in order. So it would be 2 times 2 times 3 times 3. We can also write it with exponents, which is what I have here. 2 to the second power, meaning 2 times 2, times 3 to the second power, meaning 3 times 3. So I would be fine if you'd written it as 2 times 2 times 3 times 3, unless they requested or required an exponent. The other method, though, for doing prime factorization would be the method where you're saying to yourself, and let's do it with the 45, you're saying to yourself, what is the smallest prime number that 45 will divide by? And the answer is 3. And 45 divided by 3 is 15. What's the smallest prime number 15 will divide by? That is also 3, giving us 5. And when you get to a prime number at the bottom, then you're done. So this is 3 times 3 times 5 times 5. The advantage to this method is that we have the numbers in order right away. And sometimes the factor tree method, people end up losing or forgetting a factor, where this is less likely here, but either method will work fine, whatever you prefer. So you can go 3 times 3, or 3 to the second power times 5. Now, when you're trying to find the greatest common factor for these, you are going to want to look at their prime factorization. It's not the only way to do it, but it is a nice technique, and we've already done the prime factorization, so it makes sense to do it this way. So what we would say to ourselves is, what prime factors do they have in common? Well, they both have a 3, and they both have a second 3. So 3 times 3 gives us 9. That's the greatest common factor. Now, you could also have gotten this by listing all the factors of each of them and finding the biggest one in common. But again, in this case, this is definitely going to be easier. For the least common multiple, you can list the multiples of these numbers and find the smallest one they have in common. Or we can do the prime factorization method again. You can say, all right, I'm not going to count the 3 times 3 because that's already been included. But I am going to multiply by this remaining 2, this remaining 2, and this 5. So 9 times 2 times 2 times 5, and we end up getting 180. So if that method does not make sense to you, again, you could list your multiples of 36, 36, 72, 108, and so on. 45 multiples, 45, 90, 135, 180. And in this case, the smallest one in common is pretty quick in the list. Here, you're going to simplify, which again means find the answers. Absolute value of negative 15 is the distance from negative 15 to 0 on a number line, so that's 15. Absolute value of negative 26 is the distance from negative 26 to 0 on a number line, that's 26. 15 plus 26 makes 41. So remember again, absolute value refers to distance, and it's always going to be positive. Here, the absolute value of that negative 40 is the distance from 0 to negative 40 on the number line, which is 40. But once we establish the fact that this is 40, we still have to apply that negative sign in front of it. And so that's going to make it negative 40. Here, absolute value of 5/10 is 5/10. Absolute value of negative 1 1/2 is positive 1 1/2. So we're basically adding half plus 1 1/2 to get a final answer of 2. Here they want you to use a number line to help you fill in greater than, less than, or equal to. So how does negative 4 and 84 hundredths compare to negative 8 and 48 hundredths? Pardon me. Well, negative 4 and 84 hundredths would be about here. Negative 8 and 48 hundredths would be about here. So negative 4 and 84 hundredths is greater than. It is further to the right on the number line. 7 compared to negative 7. 7 is about here. Negative 7 is back here. And of course, 7 is greater than. Here we have negative 6 and 5/10, which is about here, compared to negative 5 and 1/2, which is about here. So what we find is negative 6 and 5/10 is actually less than. And here, negative 1 compared to 0, negative 1 is less than 0. Here you have to evaluate these expressions. So evaluate means find the value. And they want us to find the value of 6j minus 3 for j equals 4, meaning when j equals 4. Now, you want to remember that number in front of letter means multiply. So this is like 6 values of j. Well, 6 values of j would mean 6 values of 4, 6 times 4. So 6 times 4 is 24, minus 3 is 21. But again, I should have some work shown by you. You should write down 6 times 4 minus 3, 24 minus 3, giving me 21. Here it's 1/2 of b, so 1/2 of 14 plus 5. Half of 14 is 7, 7 plus 5 is 12. Again, have some work shown. Here we're taking 8 plus 4 times the value of k. So 4 times the value of k is 4 times 3 and 5/10. And then you're going to add 8 to that. Here, they want you to give 3 names for the larger shaded area. So we can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tenths are shaded. So we could write it as 6/10. We could think of it as 60 squares shaded out of 100, 60%. We could also think of it as 3/5. Now, where do we get the 3/5 from? Well, we can do it by looking at this as though it's divided into fifths. And 3 of those sections are shaded out of 5. Or you could get the 3/5 also by saying 6/10. If I write that as a fraction, that can simplify to 3/5 by dividing top and bottom by 2. So basically we got fraction, decimal, percent. And then the smaller one, we have 3/100, which is 3 shaded out of 100, so 3%, which is 3/100 as a fraction. What are two other names for 120%? Well, we could think of it as 1 2/10, or 1 20/100. We could think of it as 120/100. We could change it to a mixed number. 1 20/100 would become 1 1/5. And you can't show, of course, that on just one grid. You would need a complete grid of 120 squares on a second grid. And then Jana's training for a triathlon, and she wants to eat a diet with a ratio of carbohydrates to protein to fat that is 4:3:2. So in other words, for every 4 parts of carbohydrates in her diet, she wants 3 parts of protein. She wants 2 parts of fat. So what percent of her diet is the protein? Well, her protein is the portion that's in the middle here, the 3, and it's going to be 3 out of the other portions added together, or all the portions added together. 4 + 3 = 7, + 2 = 9. So 3 out of 9. So 3 parts out of 9 parts of her food she wants to be protein. So that would be the same as 1/3. And if you take 1 and divide by 3, you get the decimal 0.3 repeating, which is 33.3 repeating percent. And then what's the ratio of carbohydrates to fat? Well, that would be the 4:2, but we would simplify that, dividing them both by 2, we'd make it 2:1. Now, remember, these are all different ways to write ratios. You can write them with the word 2, you can write them with a colon sign, you could write them as a fraction. Those are different ways to write ratios. What's the length of the segment connecting -9, 3 and -9, -2? So you could draw this on a coordinate graph and find the distance between the y values, which is 5 units. Or you could also say, well, I can see just from the information that they have the same x values. So what's the difference between the y values? What's the difference between 3 for a y value and -2? And again, 5 units. Here, without using a calculator, meaning make sure you show your work, you need to find these answers. So get a common denominator and then get your answer. The common denominator here would be 30. So we end up getting 1 11/30, 41/30, which is 1 11/30. Again, show your work. Here you should add a 0 and show your regrouping or borrowing, 86/100. Here you need a common denominator of 12. So 3 3/12 plus 2 11/12, giving you 6 2/12, which simplifies to 6 1/6. And here you'll need to get a common denominator of 15. And if you're going to use, again, the method where you're going to leave these as mixed numbers, you'll need to borrow again or regroup. So if you do that, you'll get 5 2/15. Make sure you show your work. If you want to change them to fractions greater than 1 and do it that way, that would be fine as well. But just remember, if you're going to do them as mixed numbers, this is going to be 14, and let's see, we're going to go with 15ths for the denominator. So it's going to be 14 and, let's see, 5 15ths minus 9 3/15. So actually, I take it back. You will not have to regroup in this case. You can take 3/15ths from 5/15ths without having to regroup. So it'll be a little easier than I anticipated.